Good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us for a webinar today with Milliman, Building Safeguards into Pension Obligation Bonds. Our agenda for today's session is as follows. We'll do quick logistics and introductions, then we'll do an in-depth review of pension obligation bonds and some ideas on safeguards, and then we'll take your questions. In terms of logistics, we've got everyone in listen-only mode just to keep out the background noise. We do want your questions, though. Throughout the presentation, if a question comes to mind, you can type it into your question box on your control panel. Following the presentation, we'll read the questions out loud and respond. If you have any audio or technical issues during the webinar, you can call GoToWebinar at 1-800-263-6316. We are recording this session. Later today, we will have a replay and these slides posted at nursonline.org/events. And we're pleased to have with us today two speakers. The first one is Dan Doonan. Many of you know Dan. He is the Executive Director of the National Institute on Retirement Security. Dan has more than 20 years of experience working on retirement issues from different vantage points, including as an analyst, a consultant, a trainer, and even a plan trustee. He comes to NERS after serving as a pension specialist with the National Education Association. And we're also delighted to have with us Becky Sielman. Becky has extensive technical and consulting experience in all aspects of defined benefit pension plans, including actuarial valuations, experience studies, accounting calculations, plan design, and modeling. She also has been involved in all aspects of post-retirement benefits accounting, from valuation to plan design and strategic consulting. And with that, I'll turn it over to Dan for some opening remarks. Dan?
All right. Thank you, Kelly. And thanks to everyone for joining us today. We're here to discuss pension bonds this afternoon. And this has been a big topic in the retirement industry in recent years, as borrowing costs has fallen below historic levels. And today's discussion was born out of a white paper from Milliman that lays out a case study about the town of West Hartford, Connecticut, where they first studied the issue of pension bonds and ultimately structured their pension bonds in a way to include safeguards. And I should note, a link to that white paper was included in the webinar announcement. If you haven't seen that, you can go back to the announcement and there's a link there. So while many of us in the industry talk broadly about whether pension bonds make sense, either at a certain time or in different market conditions, or ever, if they ever make sense, we do continue to see a number of jurisdictions moving ahead each year. So given that, we think it's important to further the discussion about how pension obligation bonds, or POBs, how different strategies can include safeguards, as well as understanding what we really need to be cautious about. Now, I should mention that NERS doesn't support or oppose pension bonds as a funding strategy, but we do want to see jurisdictions that choose to issue POBs proceed in a way that maximizes the likelihood of good outcomes and minimizes downside risk. Finally, I really want to thank Becky for joining us today. I think this is an important conversation, and I personally enjoyed going through the white paper myself, and I know that if you have an interest in pension bonds, you'll find today's conversation to be really valuable. So with that, I'll hand things over to you, Becky.
Thank you so much, Dan, and it's my pleasure to be with you. We're going to start out by just going through pension obligation bonds and the risks and opportunities that they present, talk through why they have perhaps gotten a little bit of a bad reputation over the past couple of decades, and then talk about new looks at pension obligation bonds and new thinking in terms of how to structure them thoughtfully to minimize the chances that they go wrong. So first off, what is a pension obligation bond? Let's start by talking about how pension plans are funded. There are a wide variety of ways to determine actuarially determined contribution to a public pension plan, but most methods consist of a contribution that's in two parts. The first is called the normal cost, and it's the cost of the benefits that are being accrued by the people who are working for the plan sponsor in this year. So it's kind of the ongoing cost of the plan. But then virtually all public pension plans are underfunded right now. They have more liabilities than assets. And so there's typically a second component to the contribution. It's often called a past service cost or amortization payment, which is an amount that is designed to bring the plan to a fully funded position over some period of time. And there are many different ways in which unfunded liabilities might be amortized or spread out over time. So there are a lot of variations in terms of how the past service cost is determined and how the normal cost is determined. And depending on how well funded or poorly funded the plan is, the normal cost might be small relative to the past service cost, or they might be about the same size, or the contribution might largely be normal cost. I've drawn a picture here of a pension plan's contribution that's fairly underfunded, so there's quite a large past service cost relative to normal cost. The total contribution for this plan is $31 million. 24 of that 31 is paying off unfunded liability. Only 7 million of that contribution is paying for the benefits being earned currently. So in a situation like this, that past service cost is not only a large number, but it's the number that's subject to volatility as the investments do maybe well one year or poorly the next year. The normal cost reflects the cost of benefits. It's independent of how well the investments perform, but the past service cost can be volatile from year to year. And if it's a big number and volatile, that means a lot of budgetary instability for the plan sponsor, which can be a very uncomfortable place to be. So a pension obligation bond is designed to partially or fully fund the plan by having the plan sponsor go out to the public market, issue taxable municipal bonds, take the proceeds and put them into the pension trust to substantially reduce or eliminate the unfunded accrued liability, and therefore substantially reduce or eliminate that past service cost. Now, of course, if you issue municipal bonds, you do have to then pay them off over time. So you substituted paying past service cost for paying debt service. But given today's very low borrowing costs, it may be very likely that the debt service, at least initially, will be a smaller number than the past service cost. I've just illustrated here a hypothetical result for this particular plan, where the debt service is $21 million. It's a savings of $3 million over the past service cost that was $24 million. The normal cost, again, is independent of the plan's assets. It's still $7 million, whether you issue a pension obligation bond or not. But you can see from this picture that the total annual cost to the plan sponsor might be substantially lower in this case, you know, $3 million lower out of a total $31 million by issuing pension obligation bonds to fully fund the plan. Kelly, can you go to the next slide, please? Thanks. So why are we talking about pension obligation bonds now? There hasn't been much in the way of issuance for quite a number of years, but there's renewed interest now, and there's been a lot of activity. A lot of pension obligation bonds have been issued in the past year or so. And why is that? Well, quite simply, we're looking at historically low interest rates. So the borrowing cost, a taxable municipal bond you might be issuing in, say, the high 2% area. So it's we've never seen rates like this. It makes borrowing very attractive. And if the proceeds are invested in a pension trust, if you can borrow at, say, sub 3% and invest at something that's, say, 6% or higher, in the abstract, you ought to come out ahead. You've borrowed at a low rate and you're investing in something that will earn higher returns over the long term. Kelly, the next page, please. So if you couple borrowing at a low rate with investing at a higher rate over time, the plan sponsor ought to reap savings. And here's a picture. It's a long range forecast for this pension plan. You can see in the very first 2 years at the left-hand side, the pre-pension obligation bond, the contribution was normal cost in dark blue and past service cost in green. And then the pension obligation bond is issued. The normal cost you'll see has gone up a bit. That's because in conjunction with the pension obligation bond, this plan sponsor chose to substantially reduce their interest rate assumption to have a more conservative measure of liability, and that increased the normal cost. But even with that increase in normal cost, the debt service payments are smaller than the past service cost payments had been. And over time, you can see the gray area in the background is what this plan sponsor's annual cost would have been without the pension obligation bond. And the cost with the pension obligation bond is lower and gets substantially lower as we go out in time. So everything's great, right? But this is a projection using the very simplistic assumption that each and every year for the next 30 years, this pension plan's investments are going to earn exactly the assumed, in this case, 6.25%. But if we go to the next page, here's the rub. If there's one thing we know about the next 30 years, it's that the investments will not earn 6.25% year in and year out. There will be some great years, there will be some horrible years, there will be some years in between. That 6.25% interest rate assumption may represent the long-term compounded returns for a particular pension plan. That is, that good years and bad years will balance one another out. But what we do know for certain is that there will be volatility in those returns. And that volatility will translate into financial outcomes for the plan sponsor. The pension trust might earn more than the 6.25% assumption. It is likely that it will earn more than the bond rate, say a 3% bond rate, but the pension trust might earn less than that bond issuance rate. And the more assets a pension plan has, the more there is the chance to lose bigger amounts of money. Of course, the flip side is true as well. Having more money in a pension trust means that there are more assets that might do better than expected, but there is risk. There's risk about what the returns will be, and there are simply, with a pension obligation bond, more assets in the pension trust subject to risk. So that's the rub. In the abstract, there should be a reward, a good outcome, but there's the possibility that there won't be. And go ahead, Kelly, to the next page. So I think most of us immediately get to the point that the risk is that if a plan sponsor issues pension obligation bonds, and then there's market volatility, and in particular market downturns, the plan would become underfunded again. So the plan sponsor would be paying past service costs again on top of paying debt service payments. And this picture just shows a particular what if scenario. What if the returns over the next 30 years have some ups and downs? And there, in this particular case, the downs happen in the early part of the period. And so there are some years early on in this projection where the plan sponsor is paying both debt service and a past service cost. Look in particular at the year that's 2029, where the contribution is substantially higher with both past service cost and debt service, because there's been some significant market downturn in the couple of years before that. So with a pension obligation bond and market downturns, the plan sponsor could end up paying more with the pension obligation bond than they would have paid without the pension obligation bond. But if we go to the next slide, the other end of the spectrum risk is that the market does really well. And that also is a negative outcome from the plan sponsor's point of view. If we have just a tremendous market run up, in this case, as we look at this particular projection, it starts to happen in about 2030, the market booms, which is great. The plan, though, it with that market performance would have become fully funded without the plan sponsor having issued a pension obligation bond. So with that booming market, the plan sponsor is left with having maybe a wildly overfunded pension plan with no way to get that surplus out of the pension plan. And meanwhile, the plan sponsor still has to pay the debt service on the bond. So in a scenario where the market just takes off, having issued a pension obligation bond will cost the plan sponsor more than if they hadn't. So at both extremes of the market, both very abysmal performance and stellar performance, a pension obligation bond, it has the potential to cost the plan sponsor more than if there had been no pension obligation bond. The next slide, please. So it's imperative, in order that all of the stakeholders can get their arms around what does real investment risk mean in terms of the financial metrics with and without a pension obligation bond, it's imperative to perform robust analysis of a wide range of potential outcomes in terms of investment returns over the lifetime of the bond, to look at the really bad outcomes, the really wonderful market outcomes, and the full range of in between, in order to fully understand how good might be, how bad might be, to quantify how market volatility will impact the funded status of the plan, annual contributions, and be able to assess the likelihood that a plan sponsor will have a lower cost or a higher cost with a pension obligation bond. So stochastic analysis, you may also hear the term Monte Carlo simulations, are a way of looking at many potential scenarios for the next, say, 25 or 30 years. And then being able to sort out the various scenarios from very good to very bad and analyze them. It's also an incredibly powerful tool for analyzing how the specifics of a pension obligation bond package impact the range of outcomes. For instance, let's just talk about the term of the pension obligation bond. Should you issue a 20-year bond or a 25-year bond or a 30-year bond? Well, you can run stochastic analysis to give you a picture of what that looks like. Is the sweet spot for a particular plan to get to be fully funded? Or would it make sense for a plan to borrow just enough to get to be, say, 80% funded or 90% funded? Stochastic analysis enables the stakeholders to understand where their particular sweet spot is for their particular pension plan. If we could go to slide 12. Here's a picture of what stochastic analysis might look like. In this particular study, we've run 10,000 randomly generated scenarios with respect to the investment returns for the next 30 years based on this particular pension plan's target asset allocation. So those scenarios are very specific to this pension plan. And so we've run 10,000 scenarios. and then sorted the results out from the very best outcomes to the very worst outcomes. The particular metric we've looked at for this slide is the net present value, so the value today of the plan sponsor's cost over the lifetime of the bond. So both their pension contributions and their debt service. And we're looking on a net present value basis so that we're looking in today's dollars at their costs over the lifetime of the bond. And the chart, the left-hand set of numbers that's labeled no POB is the expected distribution of outcomes, again, if they did not issue a pension obligation bond. Here, when the metric we're looking at is cost, a high number is a bad outcome. So the 95th percentile, those are pretty much the worst outcomes, the highest costs. A 95th percentile means 95% of those 10,000 scenarios are at that level or lower. And at the other end of the spectrum, the very good scenarios are down at the bottom in blue, the fifth percentile. These represent the top 5% of the 10,000 scenarios. And we can look at the spread from best outcomes to worst outcomes and measure the median or 50th percentile number. In this case, $737 million. So that's the state of affairs if this pension sponsor just continued on without a pension obligation bond. And then on the right-hand side, we see the same measurement over the same 10,000 scenarios, if this plan sponsor issued, in this case, a 25-year pension obligation bond, issued at a 3% interest rate assumption for the bonds, and the median outcome is more than $100 million lower. That's the expected savings for this plan sponsor for issuing pension obligation bonds. At the blue, at the bottom end, the best case scenarios are virtually the same. But the key is that the worst possible outcomes, in orange at the top, there are outcomes with the pension obligation bond that are worse than the outcomes without. So the key thing for the stakeholders here to understand is that it's likely at the median, at the 50th percentile, that this plan sponsor will save more than $100 million in today's dollars. But there is a chance, maybe a 20% chance or so, that a pension obligation bond would end up costing them more money than if they don't. So they have to be comfortable that the likely savings relative to the potential for this costing them more money is a trade-off that they are comfortable with. On to the next slide, please. The net present value is just one metric that we can explore using stochastic analysis. I like to think of stochastic analysis as a way for different questions to be posed, and we can pull out different metrics and measure them across 10,000 scenarios in order to give insight into the answer to that question. So a particular question that might be of interest is, what's the plan's funded status likely to be at the end of the bond repayment period with and without a pension obligation bond? And in fact, here we're showing you that we might look at several different POB packages side by side with one another to see how tweaking the elements of the POB package change the range of outcomes. So here we're looking at funded ratio. The good results are the very high numbers. So now orange, the good results are at the top. The blue numbers at the bottom are the very worst outcomes. And let's start with the very worst outcomes. Because of this particular plan's funding policy, even if the markets do very, very poorly, the contributions will go up to compensate. And so at the end of 30 years, the worst outcomes are kind of the same across the board. in terms of the funded ratio. But at the top side, in the orange outcomes, a pension obligation bond has a small but very real possibility of making this plan, you know, wildly overfunded. It's hard for us sitting in 2021 to imagine any plan being 150% funded, let alone 350% funded. But that is possible. And you can see, looking at the median numbers in black, that without a pension obligation bond, this plan was likely to become very modestly overfunded in 30 years. And the pension obligation bond package that this plan sponsor was looking at did actually increase the likelihood, even at the median, that the plan would end up a little bit overfunded. But that was by design. This plan sponsor wanted to err on the side of, if anything, having the pension plan end up a little bit overfunded to provide a cushion and to provide budgetary stability. Next slide, please. Here's another metric that I think is one worth a question worth asking and an easy way to answer it, which is how bad might bad be in any one given year? You know, our municipal budget can only absorb so much in terms of a pension cost, and how bad might bad be? And for this particular plan, the answer is substantially better at the median with the pension obligation bond than without. But the highest possible outcomes with the pension obligation bond are a little higher than without. So there is an increased risk for this particular plan that a one-year contribution might be higher with the pension obligation bond than without. Next slide, please. So there, I do want to pause here and provide there are a lot of words here on the screen. Read them as I'm talking if you can, but the Government Finance Officers Association, or GFOA, had a very thoughtful response to pension obligation bonds and recommended against them. And this is going back a few years. And I think that this was a very, very thoughtful look at some of the ways in which pension obligation bonds that were issued maybe 10, 15, 20, 25 years ago went wrong. I think many of us had come to the conclusion that maybe we should stay away from pension obligation bonds. But with interest rates so low, some plan sponsors were very interested in exploring pension obligation bonds to take advantage of the very low interest rate environment that we're in right now, and took the GFOA comments to heart and thought long and hard about how a new breed of pension obligation bonds might be structured that addressed these concerns voiced by the GFOA, and that focused on ways in which the things that went wrong in the past might be avoided in the future. And fundamentally, if we can borrow at sub 3% rates and invest and get returns that are, you know, north of 6%, there's a lot of potential savings there. And we can take some of those savings and, in effect, spend them in ways that strengthen the pension obligation bond package and guard against some of the risks that the GFOA comments are addressed at. So for the remainder of my presentation, I'm going to walk you through some of the concepts that have been brought to bear in the new generation of pension obligation bonds that are explicitly geared at addressing the shortcomings that the GFOA articulated. So with that, if you could go to the next. So I've called these safeguards, you might call them common sense, but the very first thing is to make sure that you are fully informed. There are a range of experts that need to be included in the team that's helping you assess a pension obligation bond. Actuaries like myself, of course, because we can help quantify risks. We can help craft funding policies. Financial advisors are key in understanding the bond market and helping plan sponsors through the credit rating process and the process of issuing the bonds, bringing the bonds to market. Investment advisors play a critical role in discussing how the pension obligation bond proceeds will be invested. And of course, bond counsel is important because a bond is a very important instrument and you need bond counsel to help with the legal ramifications. So build a team, bring them all into the conversation early in the process of crafting the pension obligation bond package so that all of those different points of view are involved. Next, it's critical to make sure that all of the stakeholders have the opportunity to see, to quantify what the risks are and the potential rewards. It isn't enough. It simply isn't enough to say we can borrow at 3 and invest in 6.25. It's a good idea. And finally, there are a lot of details. There are a lot of variations on the theme. I'll show you a bunch of them as we go through this afternoon. But each of those details is important, and each of them is specific to a particular plan. So just because the community next door structured a pension obligation bond in a particular way does not mean that that is necessarily the right way for your community to structure a pension obligation bond. Next slide, please. So one of the things that GFOA pointed to is what they termed complex instruments. Bonds can be structured in a lot of different ways, and they can have complicated call features and premium refundings and all sorts of bells and whistles. The more bells and whistles there are, the harder it is for people to understand and fully comprehend the risks. So if you want to stay safer, keep it simpler. Have just a plain vanilla level payments of principal and interest, for instance, so that the payment that the plan sponsor makes in each and every year is the same, just like a home mortgage. When doing the analysis, I think it is much easier to analyze and understand the financial consequences of the pension obligation bond if you have a debt repayment period that is the same as the period that you're using to amortize the unfunded accrued liability. This may mean that you make a change in your funding policy to change how you're amortizing the unfunded accrued liability. You may have, say, a 20-year layered amortization, but you may want to switch it to a 25-year closed amortization to match a 25-year bond. But I think that it having those two out of sync with one another can make it more difficult to fully understand the risks and rewards. Another thing to just stay away from is to use a pension obligation bond as a reason to solve a one-time budget situation, to take a one-year funding holiday in the year that you issue the pension obligation bonds. If you're thinking of a pension obligation bond as a way to get out of some budgetary situations that are short-term in nature, I think that it's a fundamental mistake to embark on a very long-term financial obligation in order to solve short-term budget issues. So think of a pension obligation bond not so much as a way to save money in the short term, as a way to save money in the long term. Make sure that you're thinking about your overall debt picture and your overall debt capacity, and that this bond in conjunction with other debt isn't overwhelming your community's ability to repay, that issuing the pension obligation bond is not going to constrain you to borrowing to meet other needs. If you've got, say, that the high school renovation looming on the horizon, take that into account when you think about your debt capacity for the pension obligation bond. This is where working with your financial advisor is very important. And think about the potential implications of issuing a pension obligation bond on the credit rating. Is issuing a bond going to be a credit positive or a credit negative or a credit neutral? The answer to that is important to the cost of not just the pension obligation bond, but subsequent borrowing. So you need to think through how you're going to present the pension obligation bond to the credit rating agencies, what other things they have pointed to in prior issuances, ratings for you, and how a pension obligation bond might be perceived. On to the next. As a pension actuary, I've been spending most of the past, say, 10 years, 15 years talking with my clients about the never-ending need to lower the interest rate assumption to keep pace with lower and lower expert thinking about future returns. This picture is taken from Milliman's public pension funding study, which I am the lead author for. We do an annual look at the funded status of the 100 largest US public pension plans. And this is one of the things that we track, is the interest rate assumptions being used by the largest pension plans relative to an assessment of what their pension asset allocations are likely to produce. And we update this picture here. This is just one hypothetical asset allocation. It's Milliman's capital market assumptions generating an expected long-term return for this portfolio. It's the same portfolio for this entire time horizon from 2001 through 2020, but each year's updated capital market assumptions, reflecting that each year since 2001, the expert thinking about future investment returns for this same portfolio has been steadily dropping. So back in 2001 for this portfolio, the expected investment return for the portfolio was 8.29%. It would have been unexceptional for this plan sponsor to have had an 8.25% interest rate assumption. But over on the far right at 2020, for the same portfolio, the future expected returns were 5.5%. Right? So that's a big decline in an interest rate assumption. And there are many plan sponsors that have been diligently dropping their interest rate assumptions, but they haven't yet dropped the interest rate assumption all the way down to current expert thinking about future returns. Well, if you're contemplating a pension obligation bond, bite the bullet, get the interest rate assumption down to where your financial advisor, your actuary, your investment consultant are recommending that it be. Have no fat, no rose-colored glasses in any of the actuarial assumptions. Inject conservatism into the process of measuring liability, because you're likely to get significant rewards from a pension obligation bond. But make sure that when you analyze those potential rewards from a pension obligation bond, that you're being as conservative as possible in how you measure liability. So the plan sponsor whose figures I showed you in a graph earlier had their interest rate assumption at 7%. And in anticipation of the pension obligation bond, they dropped it down to 6.25%. Based on advice from their investment consultant, and their actuary about current expert thinking about future returns. Even at 6.25, their pension obligation bond looks likely to save them a lot of money. So be conservative on the actuarial side when measuring the liability. An experience study is a deep dive into all of the actuarial assumptions. If you're thinking about a pension obligation bond, do an experience study right away to make sure that your retirement and turnover assumptions, your assumption about future salary growth, are in pace, up to date, and based on the most recent available information. Next page, please. Okay, let's turn to the investment side. One of the worst scenarios with a pension obligation bond is that you borrow that money, put the proceeds into the pension trust, and then we have a market meltdown. And you immediately lose some significant portion of the pension obligation bond, and you still have to pay that debt service. So one way to safeguard against that kind of scenario is to gradually put the proceeds of the bond into the pension trust's investments over not just a multi-week or multi-month period, but over a multi-quarter period. So perhaps you're going to take 6 quarters or 8 quarters to fully invest the bond proceeds. You are absolutely, potentially giving up investment returns in the short term if markets go up. You'll miss that boat. But you will also miss the boat if the market takes a sharp turn in the wrong direction. So this to me is a classic hedging situation. You're going to give up something, but you're going to get something that you think is of more value. So you're going to give up the potential for a disaster to hit right after you issue the bonds. But that action will bear a cost in terms of potential investment returns that you'll miss out on. I don't think there's any particular right answer in terms of how long that investment process, that dollar cost averaging, might take, but it is absolutely the sort of thing that could be analyzed using robust stochastic analysis. Next slide, please. Now let's talk about some funding policy options. One of the things that, well, we haven't seen a lot of overfunded pension plans in the public sector in a couple of decades, but once upon a time, there were lots of overfunded public plans, and very often, not universally, but very often, overfunded plans used their surplus to partially or fully offset the normal cost. So they would have a zero contribution or a very small contribution. Zero contribution we refer to as a contribution holiday. That's a temptation. If you have issued a pension obligation bond and fully funded the pension plan, it may well get overfunded in periods. Deliberately paying the normal cost, even when the pension plan is modestly overfunded, is a way to build up a cushion. And this is therefore a conservative approach, building up a cushion, having a funding policy where even if the plan is overfunded and you might take a contribution holiday, you choose instead to continue to pay the normal cost. Maybe not indefinitely. Maybe there's some threshold such as 130% or 150%. And if you reach that funding threshold, you do take a contribution holiday. But this is a mechanism to deliberately have a surplus. Surpluses are a way to inject pension stability. If you deliberately aim to get your pension plan up to 100 or 150% funded, you won't have budgetary volatility in the pension contribution thereafter. There's nothing less volatile than a contribution that's just zero year in and year out because the plan has gotten to be comfortably well-funded. Now, of course, there is the chance that having a policy like this will contribute to the plan becoming more overfunded than you'd like it to be, because of course, if you have surplus in the pension trust, in most jurisdictions, there's nothing you can do with that surplus. You can't take it out of the pension plan and use it for other purposes. So you're left with an overfunded pension plan. But trust me, plan sponsors with overfunded plans really are a little bit happier than plan sponsors with underfunded pension plans. So this is a chance that a lot of plan sponsors are willing to live with, because it gives them budgetary stability in return. Next slide, please. Now we get into new territory, establishing a reserve fund. This is a pot of money that sits outside of the pension trust. So it's subject to whatever your jurisdiction has in terms of rules about establishing reserve funds. But the idea is, in the year you issue the pension obligation bonds, the contribution that would otherwise be paid into the pension trust, you know, if you're going to issue, say, $300 million in pension obligation bonds, does the pension trust really need your $30 million contribution on top of that? You could divert the contribution or some portion of the contribution that you otherwise would have paid. Instead of going into the pension trust, it goes into a pension reserve fund. And that pension reserve fund is invested conservatively, something that's really not subject to much market risk, the kind of instruments that a general fund might be invested in, safe, low interest investments. And then if there's a market downturn and your pension contribution spikes, you can draw on the reserve fund to pay a portion of the pension contribution. And what constitutes a spike, what trigger you use, is something that you can play around with in the stochastic analysis to figure out a trigger that makes sense, that fits nicely within the bigger financial picture. In an example, for instance, if the trigger is 5%, suppose the contribution climbs by more than 5%. Suppose we've had a significant market downturn and your contribution is going to go up from 1 year to the next by 8%. Or maybe the trigger is based on your contribution plus your debt service going up by a specific percentage. In the event that happens, your normal budget mechanism only pays the first, in this case, 5% of the increase, and the reserve fund is tapped to pay the remainder. So the reserve fund comes into the play to help fund the pension contribution and to protect the budget, the operating budget, from volatile pension contributions. You could also have a mechanism that replenishes the reserve fund in good times. So suppose a market upswing, there's a booming market, suppose it's this year, everyone's doing great in terms of investment returns and the contribution might otherwise go down. Maybe that savings goes into the reserve fund instead, or maybe say 50% of that contribution savings goes into the reserve fund to replenish it. One of the nice things about a reserve fund is that, in theory, the money in the reserve fund could be used for other purposes. Certainly, the reserve fund monies, if there are any left over at the end of the bond period, could be returned to the general fund. There are a lot of different ways that a reserve fund, the amount that establishes it, the mechanism that determines when it gets used to help augment the budget, and the way in which it might be replenished. There are a lot of variations on all of those three themes, and stochastic analysis can help kick the tires on how different trigger amounts impact metrics such as how likely is it, given a particular set of triggers and thresholds, how likely is it that there's still a reserve fund left over at the end of the bond repayment period? After all, if you're using it, if you're going to the well too often and too much, you're likely to deplete the reserve fund before the end of the bond repayment period. And maybe you're not drawing on the reserve fund enough, or maybe you're replenishing too often, and you're in 10,000 scenarios, you know, too much of the time you're left with too much money in the reserve fund. So you can play around with the various parameters of a reserve fund in order to kind of get it to the Goldilocks place. Not too big, not too small, but just right. Now, as with these other safeguards I've talked about, this is in effect, it's a hedging mechanism. You're going to give up some potential investment income by taking money and putting it into a reserve fund that's invested in low yielding sorts of investments. So you're going to give up potential investment income. But what you're going to gain is a measure of protection against budgetary volatility. So you give up a little bit in order to get something of bigger value. And the stochastic analysis will help you balance out, help you quantify what you're giving up and what you're gaining. Next slide, please. So here's a picture of how a reserve fund might work. This is just one particular sort of real world scenario. This is scenario number 2398. It's got some good years of investment returns and some bad years of investment returns. You can see starting at the very left-hand side, 2021, we have a pension contribution. 2022, you'll see the purple bar. The entirety of the contribution that was scheduled that would otherwise have been contributed to the pension trust gets diverted to the reserve fund because that's the year the pension obligation bond is issued. And then thereafter, from years 2023 on, we have a mix of contributions to the pension trust in this sort of aqua blue, plus debt service payments in the orange. You can see the dotted line plots what the contribution would have looked like if there were no pension obligation bond. But we've got, importantly, some of these open and closed orange little bars. So the solid, purple. The solid purple bar in 2021, again, that's the amount going into the reserve fund in the year the pension obligation bond is issued. Then these open purple places are in years where the pension contribution is falling because of good investment returns. And each year, rather than having the contribution fall, the budgeted amount fall, the savings is diverted into the reserve fund to shore it up, to add to the reserve fund. So taking contribution savings and adding them into the reserve fund. And it happens in years 2033 through 5. And then again, you can see it happens in the mid 40s as well. So there we have investment ups and downs. And when there are ups and the pension contribution would be falling, we're taking contribution savings and plowing it back into the reserve fund so that the reserve fund is there to augment the budget in the years when the reverse is happening. And that's these crosshatched purple areas in the late 30s and early 40s here, where the contribution is climbing rapidly because the market is losing lots of money. So the assets are suffering, contribution is climbing, and it's a higher increase than the trigger built into the reserve fund. So the budget is paying up to the trigger amount, and the reserve fund is kicking in extra. So the pension trust is getting the full contribution, but it isn't all having to come from the budget. Some of it can come from the reserve fund. When we modeled this particular reserve fund set of parameters for this plan sponsor, there was still reserve fund money left over at the end of the bond period in 97% of the 10,000 scenarios, which indicated that it was a very robust reserve fund mechanism. And overwhelmingly, there would be money in the reserve fund to provide that budgetary stability. Now, that's that one plan sponsor. When we use that exact same reserve fund mechanism for another plan sponsor with somewhat different numbers, different investment allocation, different relationship of normal cost to past service cost, just a different plan, we got a different outcome. For the second plan, the exact same reserve fund mechanism had reserve fund monies left over at the end of the period in only 76% of the 10,000 scenarios. Not bad, but not as robust as the first one. So just a lesson to take away is that the specifics, the details of the reserve fund mechanism, how much you put in at the beginning, when and how, to what extent do you draw on it in bad times, and to what extent do you replenish in good times? Those are all things that are specific to a particular pension plan that should be played around with to come up with the package that makes the most sense for the particular pension plan. Next slide, please. And then finally, you come up with all of these various safeguards, you fine-tune them to fit your situation. Make sure that they will persist over the lifetime of the bonds, because different decision makers will be taking over stewardship of the pension plan when your time with it is done. So ensure that if you are changing a funding policy, for instance, to include paying the normal cost when the pension plan is overfunded, or to establish a reserve fund, or to protect the reserve fund from being used for other purposes, make sure that that the process of setting up those safeguards is a formal one, that to the extent you can prevent them being changed in the future, you've got as much safety as possible in ensuring that the safeguards continue to work. Make sure that you're passing on to the next generation of stewards why you had each safeguard, what it's intended to do. Make sure, for instance, here's an example. If you have a reserve fund, perhaps the reserve fund needs to be put in place through a statutory change. Write into the statute something along the lines of, if money from this reserve fund is used for any purpose other than paying pension contributions in market downturns, any other use must be preceded by robust stochastic analysis by an actuary, so that its use for other purposes will not harm the pension plan and its funding. So build in those safeguards about your safeguards now, while it's all fresh, while you know why you've got it, the way you want it to work. Put it in as much concrete as you can. Now, depending on jurisdiction, there may well be mechanisms for having statutory oversight over pension obligation bond. There may be jurisdictions where you simply can't do one, but there may be, for instance, in Connecticut, an oversight process. In Connecticut, it's the Office of the State Treasurer and the Office of Policy and Management. Massachusetts, likewise, there's statutory oversight. There may also be strings attached. For instance, in Connecticut, if you issue even a dollar of pension obligation bonds, you are required to pay in full the actuarially determined contributions for the remaining lifetime of that bond. And there are limitations on how you can lengthen the amortization period. So make sure you are fully aware of any strings attached and are prepared to comply with them. Next slide, please. Now, I want to just repeat that every pension plan is different, and the specifics of the things I've shown you today are based on a specific pension plan or two, and what's going to work for your pension plan is going to be different from what I've shown you. It's so vital to make sure that each plan sponsor that's thinking about a pension obligation bond spend the time and effort to do serious, rigorous, stochastic analysis with their professional advisors to make sure that all of the stakeholders are fully informed about not just the potential rewards, but also about the range of risks, the range of possible outcomes. Make sure that you do it within the context of the applicable statutory environment in your neck of the woods. And make sure you think through what makes sense for your pension plan and your financial situation, your budgetary demands, your long-term financial framework. And finally, no matter how well you plan and test and analyze and make sure everyone understands the risks, we have no way of knowing what will actually happen in the market over the lifetime of the bond. And with the best will in the world, you may do your utmost to protect and still come out with an adverse outcome. There's nothing we can do about what the market will do, but we can be as thoughtful as possible now to do the best to end up with a positive outcome rather than negative. So on the following slide, there is just the URL for a case study we wrote up with these concepts and some more detail for a pension obligation bond that the town of West Hartford, Connecticut issued that included all of these layers of safeguards. And I'd encourage you, if you're thinking about a pension obligation bond or want to more fully understand some of the things I've talked about today, take a look at that paper and other information available about pension obligation bonds. And with that, Dan, I will turn it back to you and we'll take some questions.
Okay, yeah, thank you very much. I think we'll turn our cameras on here and join you in person now that we don't have as much on the slides. Yeah, thank you very much. I think it's very clear in the way this is designed. When you look at the different aspects of the safeguards, that, you know, this wasn't designed for, you know, 2 or 3 years of budget savings or reducing costs in the short term, but much, much broader thinking. So we really appreciate you sharing this with our community at NERS here. I did want to ask, we had really low interest rates, as you mentioned. What are your thoughts if, you know, interest rates increase to more normal levels over the next 5 to 10 years? Any thoughts about how that might impact someone that just issued pension bonds or maybe doing so in the near future?
Well, plain vanilla bond, you know, we've locked in the interest rate at the beginning. So if interest rates rise, you sit back and say, "Ooh, we got in at a good time when rates were low." So rising interest rates may impact investment allocation decisions, may impact how well the fixed income investments perform, but won't impact that you borrowed at a nice low rate. So the biggest thing with the fear of rising interest rates is that someone who's maybe just listening today and thinking, "Hey, maybe I should think about a pension obligation bond." Well, they may rise pretty soon. So get going right now, don't wait, I guess I would say, because we do have issuers getting, you know, sub 3% rates right now, but most crystal ball gazers expect that rates are going to go up in the not too distant future.
Yeah. Okay, so I got my first question in. I think I should pass over to Kelly, who has questions from the audience for us.
Yeah, thanks. We have a couple questions from the audience. I'll just go ahead and start getting into those. Becky, does this assume a plan sponsor is doing the POB rather than the plan participant?
Yeah, a bond is issued by the plan sponsor. Right. So a plan sponsor is undertaking a financial transaction, going out into the bond market and borrowing money and taking the proceeds and putting them into the pension plan. So this is not something done by a plan participant. It's done by the plan sponsor, by the entity that is responsible for funding the pension plan. So I use plan sponsor. It isn't necessarily the employer. It's the entity responsible for funding the plan.
Any others there, Kelly? So I'm not sure if she's having audio trouble there, but in your first safeguard, you mentioned complex instruments. Can you elaborate a bit more about that? You were talking about how the bond was structured itself, right?
Right. Municipal bonds can, you know, have a lot of sort of bells and whistles, non-level repayments, they call features, you know, the GFOA, one of their bullets talking about complex instruments, you know, specified some features of bonds that made them, you know, complex. You know, there are a lot of moving parts and therefore potential for them to be not fully understood and to potentially subject the plan sponsor to having to pay unanticipated amounts of debt service. So if we can keep the amount of debt service, it's the same, just like a home mortgage, year one, year 30, exactly the same amount. That's plain and simple. It's easy to budget. It's easy to forecast. It's easy to anticipate. So it's sort of a keep it simple, stupid kind of approach. If you don't need complexity, don't add it.
Okay, thanks. I wanted to ask too, you mentioned the length of the pension bond and you talked about matching the amortization period. Outside of that restriction, do you have thoughts about longer versus shorter periods and how that might play out differently?
Yeah, it's going to vary a bit based on the demographics of the plan. Is it, for instance, a plan that covers largely public safety employees with a generally lower, shorter working lifetime? We like to have the amortization period somewhat match the expected working lifetime of the people covered by the pension plan, because as a general concept, we want to be able to pay all of the costs associated with an employee while they are working, not once they are retired. So if we've got a plan where we would want to have a shorter amortization period because of the nature of the workforce, then we'd want to have the bond be somewhat shorter as well. There may also be some, so that's a pension plan driven litmus test for the amortization period. There may also be things within the plan sponsor's financial picture that would indicate a particular length of bond that may have to do with some of their other bonded debt and other things in the plan sponsor's financial picture that would indicate a particular length of period. There may be something statutory about the length of period. For instance, in Massachusetts, there's a statutory requirement to have the pension plan funded by 2040. So that's a somewhat shorter time horizon for issuing a pension obligation bond. And finally, sometimes the numbers just point you in one direction or another. So I would routinely suggest that a plan sponsor runs a stochastic model looking at what if it's 15 years or 20 years or 25 years? How does the length of the period impact the range of potential results and the magnitude of the savings?
All right. I'm going to ask Kelly, are you there? And yeah, I'm afraid she lost audio there. I apologize. We'll try to follow up on any questions we missed. And I did want to note too, this copy of this webinar, as well as the slides, we will post this on our website. So you'll be able to get a hold of those things later. And to wrap up, Becky, thank you again. I really appreciate your work in this area and your willingness to come share it with us today. So we're really grateful. And any last words for you?
If someone comes up with safeguard number 8, let me know. Because if we can work together to put our best thinking together to come up with better and better ways to make pension obligations as safe and secure as we possibly can, that benefits everybody.
Yeah, no, I think that's right. And we try to share ideas amongst our community here. And again, super grateful for you helping out on that front. So thank you. And thank you to everyone who joined us today. We really appreciate it.
Take care. Thanks for having me, Dan. Bye-bye.
Bye.